Good afternoon, everybody. Shabbat Shalom. I hope you all are having a blessed and wonderful Sabbath day. And today we are going to be talking salvation. I hope you've already been blessed if you've been listening to Mama and her teachings earlier. I'm gonna continue on. And as I said, we're going to talk about salvation because we need to understand and know what salvation is as opposed to what they're teaching out there. So we need to know the truth of the matter according to the word of the Most High. First thing I'm going to do is I'm going to read a short quote about salvation. So to give us some insight as to what the Most High is saying about salvation. Then I'm going to show you some things. I'm going to teach you some things from the word. And I'm going to give you scripture. You know how we do. We give you a lot of scripture. So you can write them down and you can go back and study this for yourself, because it's always about what the word of the Most High says, not what I say, not what my wife says or anybody else says. Too many people are relying on man, and the word tells us trust no man, but too many people are trusting man. So everything I tell you, you can verify by the word. In fact, like I said, I'm going to give you the word as I say the things I say. So we're going to talk about salvation. First, like I said, I'm going to read this short quote, which tells us about salvation. And it reads, it says, a work is to be done in the Lord's vineyard, which will testify to the genuineness and value of the truth and will glorify the Most High. We are to labor for those who, when converted, will be a help in the work, producers, not consumers, but the work done for the lowest class of outcasts is a very uncertain matter. Those who spend their time and strength in work for those who will never do anything but hang upon them for help disqualify themselves for the position Yah would have them fill in his army. Workers are greatly needed to labor for those who, rightly handled, will come to a knowledge of the truth and will then do valuable service in the cause. But those who, after being prayed with, say, I am saved. Let me repeat that. But those who, after being prayed with, say, I am saved, have no real understanding of what it means to receive Yahshua. And what I'm getting at here is I'm saved. That mentality, when they baptize so many of us in the churches, and pretty much all of us have been baptized at least once in our lives until we come to the real truth and understand this. So understand, when you say I am saved, you have no real understanding of what it means to receive the Most High, because this is what we're being taught. But it continues. No man can say I am saved until he has endured tests and trial, until he has shown that he can overcome temptation. Those who fail to do the work which the Most High has said should be done soon lose the right perception of spiritual things and become blinded as to the character of the truth. They are unfitted to do the work which would make them complete in Yahshua. The churches must arouse. The members must take out up the church must arouse. The members must awake out of sleep and begin to inquire, how is the money which we put in the treasury being used? The Most High Elohim desires that a close search be made. Are all satisfied with the history of the work for the past 15 years? Where is the evidence of the co-working with Yah? Where has been heard throughout the churches the prayer for the help of the Holy Spirit? Dissatisfied and disheartened, we turn away from the scene. So the point I'm making in that quote right there is that the I am saved thing, because too many of us believe I am saved because I've been baptized. I am saved because I've accepted Yahshua as my Savior. People, that is one of the greatest deceptions that have been planted in the minds of men. And so many are going to be lost thinking that that is going to get them into the kingdom. So as I said, today we're going to talk about salvation. So let's talk about salvation. And now we're going to go to the word and we're going to get some quantifying definitions by reading the scripture as to what salvation means. And understand, this is just one of many studies of salvation. There are a lot of things we need to understand about salvation, but we're going to give you one aspect of salvation today, according to the word of the Most High. Now, salvation, it comes from the Greek, meaning the Greek word soteria, or S-O-T-E-R-I-A, which means to be saved. That's what salvation means. It's a Greek word. It comes from the Greek word meaning to be saved. And we're all aware as we hear that word all the time. Save, save, save. That's the definition. That's the origin of the word. And the definition means preservation or deliverance from harm or ruin. Preservation or deliverance from harm or ruin or loss. And biblically, what we're trying to be preserved or delivered from is the sin and the consequences of sin that are coming upon this world. And we see this daily. It's going on daily. And we see it getting worse and worse. And this is what we're trying to be saved from. Now, the goal or the objective should be to be saved before you die, because the degradation or the fall of this world is continually going. So we must be saved now while we have opportunity, because we may not survive his second coming. We may die before then. So we need to be saved as so many of us profess before we hit the grave, so to speak. So here's the setup question. Who's saved out there? How many of you are saved? How many of you believed you're saved? And I know for the most part, if any of you have been baptized, or if you've accepted Yahshua as your Savior, many of us firmly already believe I'm saved. But what does that mean? What do you do with that knowledge or that so-called acceptance? And this is where the problem lies, because the world teaches that's it. You're saved. You're good to go. And people go on with their lives doing the same things that they've been doing over and over and continue living their life the same way. They may modify little things, but you still aren't understanding and doing the will of the Most High. And this is what we need to be doing. So simply put, believing alone will not save you. I'm going to say it again. Believing alone will not save you, because even the devils believe. Go with me to James. Go ahead, write it down. James 2:19. James 2:19. And this is something we should clearly understand. The devil believes in a lot of things, and he believes in them because he knows they're factual. James 2:19 reads, it says, "Thou believest that there is one Yah. Thou doest well. The devils also believe and tremble." So why do the devils believe and tremble? Why does Satan believe and tremble? Why do those fallen angels, demons, believe and tremble? Because they know these things are a fact. So they shudder in what they know is factual. But that doesn't justify them. That doesn't justify Satan. They believe and they aren't saved. They're already condemned to damnation. So don't ever for a moment think just because you believe, you're saved. The example of the devil is our proof according to the word. I'm going to give you an example. Since so many of us believe that we're, I believe, I'm saved, I'm good. If you go to walk across a busy highway and there are cars coming sporadically, periodically, heavy traffic, it doesn't matter. But if you just simply put your head down and walk across the highway, I believe I won't get hit by a car. I believe. You step out there, you're going to get hit by a car. You're going to be dead and gone. And then you'll be, but I believed. Believing alone is not enough. You should have been doing something as you believed. You should have been being diligent, paying attention, doing a careful work of walking across there. I mentioned the W word and I said work. Yeah, there's something involved, people. It's not simply I believe and I'm saved. We have to be doing something. We can't just accept something and it takes care of us by itself. We have to make it work. We have to do whatever it is to activate the gift, because being saved, or salvation, as it's called, is a gift from the Most High. If we look at Romans 6:23, Romans 6:23, and we should all know Romans 6:23 as much as we use that. But I'm going to say it. I'm going to read it from the Word and give you opportunity to write it down. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of Yah is eternal life through Yahshua, our Elohim, our Lord." So the wages of sin is death. So we know that's coming. It's guaranteed. It's his word. It's already written. If we go to John 3:16, let's look at John 3:16. Another one that we should all know. John 3:16. John 3:16 says, "For Yah so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." The devils believe, but are they going to have everlasting life? So understand, we can't take a scripture and take it in a total context that's going to be satisfactory to us. That's part of it. All the promises of the Most High are conditional, meaning we must be doing our part, people. We must be doing what we're supposed to do. His promises, his word is sure. It already is. But we must do our part. So that makes them conditional on our behalf, on condition that we do what we're supposed to do. But people don't want to do what we're supposed to do. We want to take his word at face value and apply it and absolve ourselves from having to do anything. We have a work to do, people, but it's a specific type of work we need to be doing. 2 Corinthians 2:9-15. 2 Corinthians 2, chapter 9 and verse 15 says this. It says, "Thanks be unto Yah for his unspeakable gift." So salvation, like I said, it's a gift, and it's an unspeakable gift. It's incredible. It is one of the most precious, if not the most precious thing that he offers to us. He's given that to us. But all don't receive gifts, people. See, here's the trick. It's a gift, and people think because it's a gift, it's automatically given to everybody. See, everybody has that gift. Everyone has the opportunity, but only those who will receive it and do what they need to do will receive it and do what they need to do. It's a gift for the taking. It's a gift for the receiving. But all people don't do what they're supposed to do. Another analogy. If there is a food bank and you are hungry, your family hungers, and there's a food bank who offers the free gift of salvation, also known as food, you can go and partake of that free gift. But what if you don't do anything with that gift? You will perish. See, you have to do something. You have to make that gift work for you by applying it in your life the way it needs to be applied. Salvation is no different. Be it food or everlasting life. Saying I'm saved because I believe is not going to do it. You took that food from the food bank and go, "Oh, I'm saved," and then you don't eat it. What's going to happen, people? It's simple. The Most High's word is simple. It's clear, but we convolute it. We make it complicated when we don't want to see the simple truth of it. But it's very simple and clear. So here's a question. Here's another question. Is there once saved, always saved? Is that a true philosophy? No, it's not. There's no such thing as once saved, always saved. The word of the Most High is littered with examples of people who would have been saved, but ultimately they were found in ruin. If you're saved, you're saved. But there's no such thing as once saved, always saved. You can't be saved and then just go on and do what you want in life and think, "I'm good, I'm saved." Because temptation never takes a day off. Satan never takes a day off. Salvation by faith alone, people, requires something else. Salvation by faith alone is not going to get us there. So what is it that we need? Faith. We need faith, people. Hebrews 11, another very well-known scripture. Hebrews 11 and verse 1. Hebrews 11 and verse 1 says, "Now faith, Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for. So stop right there. Faith is the substance of hope. Faith is hope. We have to have that hope. Faith is the substance of hope. All things hoped for. Faith is the substance of things hoped for. The evidence of things not seen. Now, look at verse 2. It says, For by it, the elders obtained a good report. Through that hope, it says that through faith, we understand the worlds were framed by the word of Yah, so that things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Verse 4, by faith, it gets good, it gets better. It's always good, it gets better. By faith, Abel offered unto Yah a more excellent sacrifice than Cain. So by faith, what did Cain do? He did something. He offered a better sacrifice to the Most High. So he did a work, but he offered something to the Most High that was of his requirement, not of what he wanted to give him. This was Cain's problem. See, Cain wanted to do his own work, the work of man. And the Most High was like, no, I don't want that. He accepted Abel's because Abel was doing the work of the Most High. He was offering him something that would glorify him. And this is the thing. So by faith, Abel offered unto Yah a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous, Yah testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead yet speaketh. And then we go to Enoch. It says, by faith Enoch was translated that he should not see death, and he was not found because Yah had translated him. For before his translation, he had this testimony that he had pleased Yah. What did Enoch do? Enoch did something. He believed, he had faith, but he had to do something. He walked. He walked in righteousness before the Lord. So he kept the ways of the Most High. People being saved is a work. We need to be doing his work, his will. Verse 6 says, but without faith, it is impossible to please him. But with faith, it is possible to please him. So it works both ways. But without faith, it is impossible to please him. For he that cometh to Yah must believe. There's that word people love. Must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. But as we have already found out, you must believe, which people love to believe or profess they believe. But also you must be doing something. These patriarchs that were mentioned here, they did something also with that belief, with that faith. They did something. So we must be doing something. Verse 7 says, by faith, Noah being warned of good things not seen as yet, moved with fear. He moved with obedience, people. Prepared an ark. He did something. He built an ark. He believed, he had faith, but he did a work also. You see what I'm getting at? There is a work involved, people. Don't let anyone convince you there's no work. That's a lie. That's a false doctrine that the churches are teaching, that there is, that when someone like myself said is teaching that there's a work to do, that's a lie. You're saying that to be saved is by works. Yeah, his works, not our works, people. We must be doing his works. By faith, nor being warned of good things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of righteousness, which is by faith. By faith, I believe. By faith, Abraham, when he was called to go out in a place which he should after receive an inheritance, obeyed. So what did Abraham do? He was obedient. He did what he was told by the Most High. There is always a work to be done, people. But we must be doing his righteous works, not our own. Our own works are nothing. Given to the, I give to the needy. Well, I'm wealthy and I donate and I'm a billionaire. I'm a Bill Gates and I give 100,000 here, a million here. See, these people think they're going to buy their way into the kingdom. And the Most High is going to be like, what's all that? I don't know anything about that. You never glorified me. You were glorifying self. You were making yourself look good and worthy in the sight of men. That's not going to get you into my kingdom, but it'll get you into their kingdoms, into their high places, at the head of their tables and all these things. People, we must be doing the Most High's work. He's not, because if it were by men's works, many of us would never make it, because we don't have the reach that these important people do, these wealthy people do. So we'd always be down on the bottom. The Most High doesn't desire that. He doesn't require that of us. He requires us to do His will, to show that we are truly sincere. Abraham, verse 9, it says, by faith he sojourned in the land of promise and in a strange country, dwelling in a tabernacle with Isaac and Jacob, the heirs with him of the same promise. For he looked for a city which had foundations, whose builder and maker is Yah. So as we, and verse 11, through faith also Sarah herself received strength to conceive seed and was delivered of a child, and she was when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. So the Most High fills his promises, people. In some of these situations, we must have the faith to believe and accept what he says is, and be obedient to wait for the fruition of his promises. Therefore, sprang there even of one, and him as good as dead, so many of the stars of the sky in the multitude, and as the sand which is by the sea shore innumerable. So clearly, people, there is a work involved. All these individuals mentioned here in Hebrews 11, they did a work, a glorifying work to the Most High. They didn't just simply believe. They weren't just simply walking around going, I accept the Savior, I'm saved. They understood, as we need to understand, there is a work involved. This is part of salvation. You can't just accept and think you're done, because temptation will drag you back into the world and drag you into your grave, and you will die in sin. And when you wake at the second death, you'll realize, I didn't do something as I was supposed to do. So in other words, we must be doing the will of the Most High, and anyone can claim they believe, but as people do this, they are in a deception. Now, it can be partly or it can be totally, as we just walk around with this ideology in our mind that I'm saved, I'm good, I accepted the Savior, I've been baptized. That is a deception being propagated all throughout the world through the churches. And you know who's behind that? The enemy is behind that. He wants us to think that. Anyone can claim this gift, people. Anyone can claim it. But if they never open it and use it as it's received, it is of no use. Gifts have to be open, and then we have to make use of them for them to be effective. And this is the same with salvation. It is a gift we must take, and we must have to apply it and use it properly to get the proper results. And many people don't do this. Now, Matthew 22 and verse 14. Matthew 22 tells us something here. As I've been saying, see, this gift is available to everyone. It is a gift available to everyone, but everyone won't receive it. Everyone won't accept it. But all who do will be rewarded. Matthew 22 and verse 14 says, for many are called, but few are chosen. Many are called. See, the Most High calls. He calls all of us. See, he wants all of us to be saved. So the calling is for all, but all won't receive the call. All won't acknowledge the call. His works, people understand, are his ways. And this is what we must be doing. We can't be walking in our own ways and claim that we love him. We can't walk in our own ways and claim that we love him and say that we're saved. He says, if we love him, keep his commandments, John 14, 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. In other words, he says, if you love me, if you think you're saved, if you want to be saved, he says, you must be walking in my ways and not your own. Deuteronomy 5 and verse 33 reads, it says, here's some of the qualifications of being saved. Deuteronomy 5 and 33 says, ye shall walk in all the ways which Elohim your Yah had commanded you, that ye may live, and that it may be well with you, and that ye may prolong your days in the land which ye shall possess. Yeah, it's Old Testament, but it applies to us all. It has to start somewhere. Anything that starts at the beginning is old. That doesn't mean it goes away. His word is forever. It endures eternity. So this applies to us also. Are we not spiritual Israel? Another study. But we all need to be doing these things. He gives us clarification over and over. We must be walking in his ways if we want to prolong our lives. Understand, no one who does not walk in the ways of the Most High is going to prolong their days on this earth. They're going to be shortened. Now, the wicked may seemingly live a long time, and some do, but that's at the hands of the enemy. So we must understand that we shorten our days when we are outside of the will of the Most High, because the enemy could take us out at any time, because there's no protection. There's no protective hedge around us. And this is what the enemy wants. He doesn't want us to have that hedge around us. Luke 1 and verse 6. Go with me to Luke 1 and verse 6 says this. It says, we're going to start at verse 5. It says, there was in the days of Herod, the king of Judea, a certain priest named Zacharias, and of the course of Abia, and his wife was of the daughters of Aaron, and her name was Elizabeth. So we're looking at Zacharias and his wife Elizabeth. And verse 6 says, and they were both righteous before Yah, walking in all the commandments and ordinances of Elohim, blameless. So they were found righteous. Why? Because they were walking in his ways. Faith, being saved, it requires us to be in his ways, people. That's the work. We have to be doing what he requires us to do. We must be walking in his ways. Being saved is about a walk, people. It's about a walk, not merely about a profession. A profession is nothing. Anyone can profess anything. And we have all experienced people professing things right in our face and knowing that it's a bald-faced lie. Professions are a dime a dozen. What do people recognize most about individuals? Their character. We observe people, and we gather more from observing people than we do listening to them. Because even when people are talking to them, more often than not, you're looking at them, watching their body language and their posture and all these things. And we discern, those of us who have the ability, we discern whether we believe them to be truthful or not based on their actions more so than the words, because words can lie in a heartbeat. But we must be actively striving, people, to be spiritually delivered, to be spiritually saved from this ruin or the consequences of sin. And this is not, and we're to do this not according to our works, according to his works. 2 Timothy 1:9 says this. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, who have saved us and called us with an holy calling, not according to our works, but according to his own purpose and grace, which was given us in Yahshua before the world began. So this is not according to anything we do, people. We must be doing these things according to his works, what he's called us to do. But people don't teach that, and people don't know it, because many don't want to hear it. They want to hear what's soothing and pleasing to their ears, so they can go on living their life the way they want. Titus 3, 5 through 7 also chimes in here and says this. Titus 3, 5 through 7 says, not by works of righteousness which we have done, not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us. According to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Yahshua, our Savior. How much more clearer can the word of the Most High? But like I said before, with this type of teaching, and I'm teaching you and showing you from the word, and I've given you the scriptures, but with this teaching, there are many people that'll imply, and they'll say, Oh, Brother Lloyd, you're teaching that being saved is by works. Yes, I am. By his works. And it better be by his works, because that's the only saving grace that can save us, that can get us to the kingdom, by doing his works and by his love, by his mercy, by his power. Because if we're doing it of our own volition, we'll never see the kingdom. Much of the world, like I said, is teaching that being saved is simply about this profession. I've been baptized, I'm saved. All you have to do is do the best you can. You've accepted the Savior, you do the best you can. You do some good things and for other people, and you be as well-mannered as you can and stand as upright as you can. People do all this in the sight of men. But out of the sight of men, they're wicked and evil. And the Most High knows. He knows their heart. He knows all our ways. He knows everything. And many would be amazed if they could know who they thought were going to make it to the kingdom won't come within of being raised from the dirt to seeing the kingdom. That's as far as they're going to get, being raised to the second death. The world teaches that once you make this profession, though, of this free gift, salvation, accepting this free gift by your mouth, that it can't be taken away from you. That's that once saved, always saved mentality. And this is the trick. This is the trick of the enemy. But like I said, we must be walking in the Most High's ways. And the world stops short of teaching that. It's amazing to me, because I've been baptized a time or two in my life before I came into the truth, as well as many of you. But it's amazing we venture into these churches and we get fired up, and we go down there and we join, and they take our information down and they sign us up for baptism, and that day comes and they dunk us in the water and do you accept Christ and do you this and do you that and dunk you and say you've been saved. And sometimes they assign someone to keep in touch with you and supposed to lead you and steer you over the next year. That seldom to little ever happens, but that's all they do. And then we just continue going to church, listen to these itchy ear sermons and these feel good things and listening to all this loud music and watching the entertainment across the pulpit. And this is how we spend our lives. And we leave right out the church doors and go right back in the world, because we haven't learned the truth. We haven't learned how to walk in his ways. We don't even know, a lot of us, we don't even know that we had better be walking in his ways. Or we've merely just been bumping our gums, as it said. We've just merely been putting rhetoric out there. We've been lying and deceiving ourselves. And that is the sadness of it all. But we must be walking in his ways, people. The devil takes truth and he adds a little lie in there. Now, understand, if you take any truth and add a little bit of a lie, the whole thing's a lie. But it's surrounded by so much truth, many people can't see it. And you know why they can't see it? Because they don't, 2 Timothy 2:15, this, study the word. If you study the word, you can spot truth in the middle of a whole dissertation. If it's just a little bit of truth, you go, oh, that was a lie. This whole thing's no good. And that's what we need to be doing. But you have to be studying to know this. Galatians 5:9 says something here. It says this. Galatians 5:9. It tells us that a little bit of leaven does what, people? A little bit of leaven. Leaveneth the whole lump. So we must be on our P's and Q's when it comes to understanding and knowing truth. Galatians 5:9 says, a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump. So, you know, and people don't really buy into the reality of that. But if you take a little bit of poison, you have a beautiful plate of food. If somebody puts an eye drop, one drop of poison in there, are you going to eat it? You're going to, I don't want that. Why? It's just right there in that one spot where they dropped it. But see, you understand. You just poisoned my whole plate. I don't want it. If you find a hair in your food at a restaurant, you give them the whole plate back. You don't just remove the hair. See, so a little bit of corruption corrupts the whole thing. We live this and we know it. But we can be picky about what we want to pick and choose from that's going to benefit us. But the truth of the matter is, it's a reality all the time. And this is how we should be living our lives. A couple more things here. Acts 16. Let's go to Acts 16. Acts 16. And we're going to start with verse 25. Acts 16, verse 25. And it reads, it says, "And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto Yah, and the prisoners heard them." What happened to Paul and Silas? They got thrown in prison. In the name of the Most High, in the name of Yahshua. And they're sitting in prison, but they're singing and rejoicing. "And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto Yah, and the prisoners heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundations of the prisons were shaken, and immediately all the doors were open." Bam! "And everyone's bands were loose." Bam! Chains fell off. Ankle chains fell off. The doors fell off. They were free. They were free to go. "And suddenly," then verse 27, "and the keeper of the prison, awakening out of his sleep, seeing the prisoner's prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, 'Do thyself no harm, for we are all here.' Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul." So there's a situation going on here. Now the guard was placed in charge of the welfare of the prisoners. So he understood his position, and he knew that if anything weird happened, like prisoners escaping, it was his life. So the revelation from this earthquake, understanding all this, was he said, "That's it, my life is over." So he was going to commit suicide because he knew that they were going to take him out. What happened to my prisoners? They were going to cut his head off. They were going to crucify. He was going to lose his life by his superiors. But Paul said, "No, don't do that to yourself. We're here. We're not going anywhere." Now the beauty of this is, let's look at the Geneva with verse 27 here. And I'm going to read this note to you. Acts 16, verse 27 in the Geneva reads, it says, "Then the keeper of the prison walked out of his sleep, waked out of his sleep, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had fled." Now, the note in the Geneva, and I know some of you have been asking about the Geneva, this is a 1599 to 1599. Now, the 1560 has the Apocrypha in it. Get both. You'll have the Apocrypha and you'll have the one without the Apocrypha. And this is the 99. But the note here says, "The merciful Yah, Elohim, so often as he listened, draweth men to life, even through the midst of death. And whereas justly they deserve great punishment, he showed them great mercy." So this guard, who his Roman superiors would have killed, the Most High called him, called upon him. He put that on his heart. He offered him salvation. And then verse 28 says this. Verse 28 says, "But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, 'Do thyself no harm, for we are all here.' Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, 'Sirs, what must I do to be saved?'" See, the Most High called him to salvation because he knew his heart. But men would have judged him outside of, "Oh, he's a Roman. He's wicked." There were plenty non-Jews that were called to salvation. There are going to be plenty non-literal Jews that are going to be in the kingdom. And we are hoping to be some of them. Spiritual Israel people. Another teaching, like I said. So we must understand these things. The Most High, like I said, he knew the guard's heart. He knew his situation. He knew what he was seeking, and he offered it to him. And notice one thing, what did Paul do here? Paul didn't jump the gun and intervene. He waited. He waited as we must do. A lot of times, people, we try and jump ship in front of the Most High directing us. And when we do so, we're going to have problems. Paul waited until that little voice said, "Now do this." And this is something we must do. When we hear that voice, That audible voice, the set apart spirit, wisdom, when we hear that voice, this is when we act. Not before, not lately after, when we decide to, when we're told, when the Most High calls on us to do anything, to react, this is when we react. This is when the blessing is the greatest, people. So Paul only moved after the Most High went before him. And this is what we need to be practicing in our lives. And Matthew 19 shows that being saved also, if we go to Matthew 19, it shows us that being saved is equated to entering the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 19, and look at verse 23. Matthew 19, verse 23. Matthew 19, verse 23 through 26. It says, then said Yahshua unto his disciples, verily I say unto you, that a rich man should hardly enter into the kingdom of heaven. And again I say unto you, it is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for a rich man to enter into the kingdom of Yah. When his disciples heard it, they were exceedingly amazed, saying, Who then can be saved? Who then can be saved? So we're seeing here that, like I said, entering into the kingdom is entering into the kingdom of heaven is being equated to being saved. Because his disciples said, well, who then can be saved? So they understood, as well as we should understand, being saved is equal to entering into the kingdom of the Most High. And this is what we should be striving for. And then verse 28 says, and Yahshua said unto, verily I say that you, and verse 28 says, and Yahshua said unto them, verily I say unto you, that ye which have followed me in the regeneration, there that is again, when the Son of Man shall sit in the throne of his glory, ye also shall sit upon the 12 thrones, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. Judging the 12 tribes of Israel. So even the elect, those who are chosen, they are going to have a place in the kingdom. And then verse 29 says, and everyone that have for... Listen to this one. And everyone that had forsaken houses or brethren or sisters or fathers or mother or wife or children or lands for my name's sake. We've been asked to do a lot, aren't we, people? So we think. Or for my name's sake shall receive an hundredfold and shall inherit everlasting life. Now, when we look at what we're being told we need to sacrifice, what's more worth, what's it worth to you? Is your houses and friends, mother, father, sister, brother, the wickedness of this world worth everlasting life? You do the comparison, and people do it every day, all day. And some keep hanging on to family. Some keep hanging on to their stuff. Some keep hanging on to the houses because they love the things of the world more than they love the Most High. But we in this household, we already know. We'll forsake all. And there's been some forsaking going on in our lives, not just today, not just yesterday, over the years, because we already understand that if, especially when it comes to people, if those people in our lives, being friends, family, or so forth, if they don't want to make it to the kingdom, why should we go down in perdition with them if that's their destination, if that's their desire? If they want to live in the world and hang on to the things of the world, why should we sacrifice what the Most High is offering us? Sacrifice self, die to sin, and reap the benefits of his offering, the blessings of his promises. This is what we should be doing. Verse Luke 18, 9 to 18, Luke 18, 29 and 30 says this. Luke 18, 29 and 30 says, and he said unto them, verily I say unto you, once again, Yahshua speaking, he said, verily I say unto you, there is no man that had left house or parents or brethren or wife or children for the kingdom of Yah's sake, who shall not receive manifold more in this present time and in the world to come, life everlasting. Promises are abundant, people. What he promises us far outweighs anything that the world can offer us. But we have to get out of this flesh. And the only way to get out of this flesh is to surrender it. We must be willing. We must choose to come out of this flesh. You know, we must choose to be that sweet savior to the Most High, that sweet smell to him. 2 Colossians 2, 15 and 16. I'm going to get ready to close here. 2 Corinthians 2, verse 15 and 16 says this. 2 Corinthians 2:15-16 says, "For we are unto Yah a sweet savior of Yahshua in them that are saved and in them that perish. To the one we are the savior of death unto death, and to the other a savior of life unto life. And who is sufficient for these things?" So we can be one or the other, people. And it's a matter of our choosing. But the notion of being once saved, always saved, I've saved, I'm professing, is not it. We must be willing to do the work that's required of us. Romans 6:11 tells us this. Let me read it. I don't want to paraphrase it. Romans 6:11 says this. This is what we need to be doing, people. Romans 6:11 says, "Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto Yah through Yahshua our Lord." Now, reckon. Like my wife always says, write it down. Reckon. It is in the Strong's. It is the Greek word, Greek 3049. It comes from the Greek. It means to take inventory. Take inventory. Or take an estimate of something, literally or figuratively. In other words, we need to continually be taking inventory, checking ourselves, because bottom line, there's no once saved, always saved. But when we believe there's a once saved, always saved, or I'm saved, I don't have to do anything, we stop taking inventory of ourselves. And when we stop taking inventory of ourselves because we think we're good, temptation is always around the corner, and so many fall because they think they're good. We must continually be taking an inventory of ourselves, because this mere profession is not going to do it. Because if you believe that, you're going to wake up at the second death not understanding why. What happened? Lord, I did this, I did that. He don't want to hear about us wicked after the fact. We made our choices. He's given us all we need. He's given us all we need to understand. And I'm going to close with this last scripture. Genesis 50 and verse 20 says this. "But as for you, you thought evil against me, but Yah meant it to be good, to bring to pass as it is in this day, to save much people alive." And this was Joseph. See, a lot of times the Most High will allow the enemy to run his evil upon us because of our sins, because we're in his way, because we're not doing what we're supposed to do. And the enemy will rain his wickedness upon us, but we still must endure. And Joseph showed us, even when he was unjustly accused of committing a crime he didn't commit. He was thrown in jail, but because he still was faithful and loved the Most High granted him favor through men, even in jail. And in the end, it was all for a purpose, because he saved many people being obedient, even his brothers who were wicked before 20 years prior, and sold him into slavery and had brushed him off as dead. But see, he held no grudges. He did what was right. He walked in the ways of the Most High. And this is what we need to do, people. We must be walking in the ways of the Most High, doing that work towards salvation. So I hope that we all understand that there is a work involved. I'm saying there is a work involved. Not our work, his works. We must be doing his works. The Most High is calling all of us, but all of us ain't gonna choose to do it. Only those who have an ear to hear will receive the call and do what they need to do. So once again, this is Brother Lloyd. I love you all, and we will be back with more videos. and you all continue to have a blessed and wonderful Sabbath day.